You don't have Wi-Fi then?
No, I just have my presentation. I was reviewing it.
I got 20% more audience.
We're not expecting anyone else, are we?
No.
I'm not going to take this with
me. Oh, it's literally more. All right, two more minutes.
Two more minutes.
Oh, good. Yes. Let's put the
text all your friends.
Timer. Ryan, quick.
Last time I put a stopwatch in front of me, I forgot to press start.
A very mystical presentation.
Yeah.
You know, the unpresent as if present. You know.
I'm gonna use my high-tech Microsoft Fit Watch to time myself. So
you're in English. You're presenting in English as
yes,
well.
Yes. Oh, we just lost one person.
The presentation is going to be in English. If anyone needs a translating device, you better get it now.
Oh yeah, tell them we're about to start.
Yeah.
Get on in here.
Get in here.
You can take the boy out of Texas. You can't. Did they act interested?
They were waiting, yes. Waiting for something.
It was an act. It was an act.
It's the one they've been waiting for. Because it's the last one.
At least we're all relaxed.
Yeah, we're very relaxed.
Shall we?
Are they filming these things?
Oh, God, I hope not.
No, actually, they are.
Yeah, okay.
Shall we start then? Welcome to a breakout session on Masonic biography. I'm Rhys Hosseini here. I'll be moderating this panel, which mostly means trying to keep everyone to 20 minutes per presentation and then 5 minutes for questions. I'll introduce each one of the presenters and at the end I will summarize for all. So our first presenter then is Dr. Simon Mayers. He's a researcher in religious histories and discourse whose main interest related to the history of anti-Semitism, anti-Judaism, and anti-Masonry, and in particular, how Jews and Freemasons have been stereotyped and mythologized, sorry about that, in modern and early modern religious discourse. Among his past research projects are an examination of stereotypes and caricatures in the literature and journalism of G.K. Chesterton, and stereotypes of Jews and Freemasons in English Catholic discourse during the second half of the 19th century and the early 20th century. Dr. Mayers is assistant editor of Melilla and a member of the British Association for Jewish Studies and the European Association for Jewish Studies. He's currently working on a 3-month postdoctoral project at the University of Manchester, examining the Bible commentaries and sermons of Methodist theologian Adam Clark. His presentation today will be on the prolific author Dudley Wright, Freemason, Theosophist, Buddhist, then anti-Masonic, anti-Jewish Catholic, and anti-Catholic Muslim, sometimes sequentially and sometimes in parallel, a fervent believer looking for a cause, although I believe he preferred calling himself a seeker after truth. Dr. Mayer?
Is this on? It doesn't sound like it's on. Yep. Okay. Great. Okay. So yes, just before I start my paper, just to clarify then. So my background is actually religions and theology. So this is a little bit of a sideways excursus for me into a character that I met during my PhD. So on that note, I'll read you my paper. I'd like to talk to you today about Dudley Wright. I first encountered Dudley Wright during my PhD, which examined myths and stereotypes about Jews and Freemasons in English Catholic texts during the early 20th century. Prior to 1933, Dudley Wright authored a number of books and articles about Judaism, Islam, and Roman Catholicism. In these, Wright was bitterly critical of Roman Catholicism and highly complimentary about Islam and Judaism. In 1932, as a result of a book he wrote on the Talmud, he was described by a prominent rabbi in the Jewish Chronicle as a righteous Gentile. According to Wright, quote, "The Talmud is an inexhaustible mine embodying the purest gold and the most precious of stones. Its maxims and its ethics instill the teachings of reality and morality of the very highest order." Can you all hear me okay? I just want to check before I carry on. Great. Unexpectedly, in 1933, he converted to Roman Catholicism and joined an English Catholic organization entitled the Catholic Guild of Israel, an organization that was dedicating to solving the so-called Jewish problem and to saving Jewish souls by bringing them into the church. At around the same time, Wright allowed his membership of at least two of the Masonic lodges that he was a member of to lapse. In the Catholic Guild of Israel's archives, there are several letters and manuscripts by Dudley Wright, in which, in dramatic contrast to his earlier discourse, he repeated traditional anti-Semitic stereotypes of Jewish greed and conspiracy. He also demonized the Talmud that only a few years previously he had praised. It was no longer a treasure trove of precious wisdom, but rather a source of poisonous statements. So initially of interest to me is just one nexus amongst many in a landscape of discourses about Freemasons, Jews, and Catholics, which is for my PhD. Dudley Wright now also interests me as an individual who refused to embrace the modern spirit of secularization and cultural demythologization, countering it instead with a quest for spiritual truth, esoteric wisdom, and cultural reenchantment. In this respect, he was not entirely unlike other esoterically minded Freemasons of his time, such as William Westcott and Arthur Edward Waite. It is with these interests in mind that I've recently been working with John Belton, who I don't think is here at the moment, to examine Dudley Wright's published and unpublished works, with John focusing on the Masonic aspects of his life, whilst I concentrated on his theological discourse. As a Freemason, Dudley Wright was a member of several lodges and was on the editorial team of a number of prominent Masonic periodicals. For several years, he was the assistant editor and briefly the principal editor of the main English Masonic newspaper of his time, The Freemason, and was also the founder editor of another newspaper called The Masonic News. He published several books on the traditions, legends, and history of Freemasonry, and was responsible for two multi-volume editions of Gould's History of Freemasonry, which was a fairly famous volume. In addition to his work on Freemasonry, he also published articles and books on various religious, spiritual, and esoteric traditions. He had a keen interest in psychic and supernatural phenomena, and wrote many articles and books on diverse fields such as vampires, poltergeists, the afterlife, and resurrection. He was, to use his own phrase, a truth seeker on a spiritual journey. He believed that all religions and mystery traditions share a universal spiritual foundation. And one of the goals which permeated his discourse throughout his life, despite the fact that his discourse changed a lot, was to trace the core truths which he believed all religious systems shared. From 1906 until 1949, he published nearly 30 books and more than 200 articles in a wide variety of Masonic, Buddhist, Islamic, Jewish, Christian, Theosophical, and other religious magazines. And according to a recent book, he also published 815 reports in the Times newspaper as the Masonic editor. Having provided some background information about Dudley Wright, I'd like to focus for the rest of my paper on the earlier years of his discourse. In 1908, 4 years prior to becoming a Freemason, Dudley Wright published a series of short essays relating to the Hebrew and Christian scriptures in magazines such as Spiritual Power, The Homiletic Review, and The Bible Review. And these were fairly fringe publications, small publications in England at the time. Wright also published his first book, Was Jesus on the Scene, in 1908. In this book, Wright argued that Jesus was a member of the Essenes, a Jewish sect at the end of the Second Temple period, rather than the Son of God, or a part of the divine trinity. At this stage of his life, and until he converted to Catholicism in the early 1930s, Dithyroite did not consider himself a Christian. When he wrote a letter to the Jewish Chronicle in 1910, he explicitly identified himself as a, quote, Gentile, but not a Christian reader of the Jewish Chronicle. Whilst he held Jesus in high esteem as a teacher, he was often critical of what he referred to as orthodox forms of Christianity. Was Jesus an Essene contains the earliest evidence of his then antipathy for so-called orthodox Christianity. Dithyroite argued, perhaps somewhat over-imaginatively, that Jesus was influenced by Eastern religions such as Buddhism. In support of this, he observed that a recently discovered manuscript, a copy of a chronicle of the life of Jesus, showed that Jesus spent a period of his life in monasteries in India and Tibet. In a passage that reminds me a little bit of Dan Brown's The Da Vinci Code, he observed that this chronicle was so inimical to orthodox Christianity that a certain cardinal of the Roman Catholic Church offered to recompense the discoverer of the chronicle for the expense to which he had been put and the time occupied in research if he would abstain from publishing it and hand it over to the papal power. According to Wright, this demonstrated that orthodox forms of Christianity, quote, failed to catch any of the spirit of the teachings of Jesus. Wright was also involved in speculations of a more occult and psychical nature. In 1908, he monitored a series of tests involving so-called thought readers for the Annuals of Psychical Science, a periodical that he was the editor of in 1909 and 1910. According to Wright, the purpose of the periodical was to examine, quote, well-attested observations of telepathy, clairvoyance, premonition, and apparitions. In 1910, Wright published a booklet and an article examining questions relating to reincarnation, previous lives, immortality, and the fate of the soul. Wright believed that psychical science, his phrase, was gradually demonstrating the likelihood of some form of continuity of life after death. However, he rejected dogmatism, suggesting that it was necessary to be open to the possibility of being proven wrong. The danger, he explained, lies in our becoming dogmatic, as dogma has been the cause of the degeneracy of every religious system. This degeneracy or corruption of religious systems, according to Dudley Wright, was an important subject for him. Whilst Wright expressed skepticism about the value of sacred texts as sources of literal history and dogma, he considered them essential as sources of parables and hidden wisdom. In two articles published in 1910 and 1911 in The Theosophist, Wright observed that the Essenes regarded the sacred texts as parabolic rather than historical. So just as a side note, for anyone that's not familiar with the Essenes were a Second Temple Jewish movement, so basically around at the same time as the Gospels of the New Testament were written. People often hear of the Pharisees and the Sadducees, which are mentioned in the New Testament, and the Essenes were another group, which generally held to be a mystical, initiatory type of sect, but very little is actually known about them, to be sure. It was, he argued, their spiritual or hidden meaning, rather than a literal rendering, that was important. Wright believed that for students in the mysteries of all scriptures, it was important to look for the, quote, deep substratum of esoteric and occult teaching, some gem buried deep beneath the soil. The spirit of truth, he concluded, cannot be directly communicated to the world, but must be presented first in the form of parables. Wright also sought for truth in a number of other esoteric sources. For example, he examined folk tales and testimonies about supernatural creatures such as vampires and poltergeists. In July 1910, Wright published an essay entitled A Living Vampire in the Occult Review, which was basically it was a testimony of a witness testimony of a supposedly living vampire. The Occult Review was a monthly magazine contributed to by notable writers on the occult, such as Aleister Crowley, I'm sure most of you will be aware of, and Arthur Edward Waite, a prominent Freemason and like Dudley Wright, someone who was interested in esoteric questions. A few years later, he expanded this essay on vampires into a book entitled Vampires and Vampirism. And if you take a look on Google Books, you'll find out that it's still popular today. Around this time, he also published a book about a prominent poltergeist episode, which supposedly occurred in 1717 at the family home of John Wesley, the founder of the Christian Methodist movement. That book was based primarily on letters between the various Wesley family members. And I've actually, because I'm currently doing postdoc research in Methodist archives in Manchester, I've actually found some of those letters that Dudley Wright refers to. In addition to the occult, spiritualism, and psychical science, Dudley Wright was also interested in Buddhism. From 1911 to 1913, he published a number of articles and books about Buddhism, and he was for a time the editor of the Buddhist Review. In 1913, Wright argued in the Buddhist Review that, quote, all religious systems are characterized by the same historical development. There is first the teaching of truth, impurity, and simplicity, so far as it can be ascertained. Then there is traceable the gradual accumulation of errors, until sometimes there appears to be no visible truth, a visible trace of the truth or foundation left. It was the original unsullied foundation of truth, prior to the accumulation of human errors, a kind of universal original error religion, that Wright often seemed to be in search of. Wright argued that unlike Christianity and other major religions, the fundamental principles of Buddhism have not changed from those originally taught by Buddha. He acknowledged that very small additions had been added to Buddhism since the teachings of Buddha, but he contended that the foundation remains clearly visible. He concluded that Buddhism was the, quote, ultimate of human thought and aspiration, for no religion or philosophy since evolved has surpassed it either in simplicity or grandeur. According to Wright, if the various religions that have sprung up since the days of Buddha are examined and the essential doctrines noted, it will be found that the basic principles are all to be found in Buddhism. A couple of years later, Wright found himself drawn instead to Islam. And in 1915, Islam seemed to replace Buddhism in his thinking as the purest of religious systems. The first of his many articles in Islam was published in the Islamic Review in August 1915. In this article in the Islamic Review, as he had previously as a psychical researcher, spiritualist, and Buddhist, he argued again that all religious systems have truth at their foundation. Nearly all of them had degenerated from their original foundation. It was, however, now Islam's turn to be the, quote, one religious system in which this downgrade tendency is absent. As he had previously with Buddhism, he argued that the core belief of contemporary Islam are precisely as they were when they were first propagated by its founder, Muhammad. According to Wright, Islam was not a new religion, but rather an uncorrupted version of the original religion, that universal air religion that he was so looking for. Significantly, Wright had previously made a similar point also about Christianity, similarly observing that Jesus did not introduce a new religion, but was just trying to return a religion to its original purity. According to Wright, the various prophets, such as Noah, Abraham, Ishmael, Moses, Jesus, and Muhammad, had each been sent to restore various forms of human corruptive religion to their original purity. Wright concluded that into the midst of religious confusion came the word of God, spoken through Muhammad. When he first wrote about Islam in August 1915, he was not as yet a Muslim. However, by September, he had embraced Islam. The Islamic Review reported his conversion and listed his name amongst other prominent converts. The mosque that he joined was part of the Ahmadiyya movement, a relatively liberal, non-sectarian, and to this day, little known and often persecuted branch of Islam. So nothing to do with Sunni Islam, nothing to do with Shia Islam. This is like another group, less well known and smaller. Like Dudley Wright, the Ahmadiyya movement believes that there is common ground in the core teachings of all religions and recognizes the founders of Islam, Judaism, Christianity, Buddhism, Confucianism, and other major religions as prophets of God. This esoteric quest for universal truth can also be found in his writings about Freemasonry. And I suspect that it was this search that led him to Freemasonry in the first place. Wright was initiated into Freemasonry in 1912. By 1918, he was writing essays about Jewish and Masonic legends, and in particular about King Solomon and the Jewish Temple, which he later expanded into a book entitled Masonic Legends and Traditions. In 1919, he argued in a book entitled The Eleusinian Mysteries and Rites, that at one time the ancient mysteries of the various nations were the principal vehicle for the existence of religion throughout the world, and that without them the very idea of religion would have died out. He suggested that if Freemasonry and the ancient mystery religions were not connected, then their close resemblance was a remarkable coincidence. And he observed that the Eleusinian mysteries of Greece and Rome bore a striking resemblance to some of the rituals of Freemasonry. As he had previously with Christianity, Islam, and Buddhism, he hinted that the various mystery religions were related to an original but now veiled underlying religion. He also suggested that Freemasonry was in some way connected to the rituals and traditions of the ancient Jewish Essene sect. In 1924, in a book entitled The Ethics of Freemasonry, he suggested that Freemasonry was the latest unifier of religious truth. According to Wright, unlike each of the individual religious systems of the world, Freemasonry, quote, is a unifier, not a divider. It soars far higher than any of the religious systems that have found a home among the dwellers on earth. Within its temple, they gather together for one common aim and object, Jew and Gentile, Muslim and Buddhist, Parsi and Confucian, ignoring, because forgetting, the divisions that will separate them when they leave the shelter of the sacred fane. Dudley Wright, of course, shared such interests in common with other esoterically minded Freemasons of his time period. For example, William Westcott, a member of the English Rosicrucian Society and a founding member of the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, had argued in 1900 and in 1919 that the purpose of Rosicrucianism was to provide a means of investigating and engaging with the esoteric symbolism of art and literature from the ancient world, the myths and mysteries of the past, and the rituals of Freemasonry. He advocated the exploration of theosophical, occult, and mystical ideas, the same ideas that Wright had explored from 1906 onwards. Westcott also expressed an interest in the Kabbalah and Hebrew antiquities. And similarly, Wright wrote a number of essays in which he expressed his appreciation for rabbinic wisdom, Jewish mysticism, and the Talmud. And again, like Westcott, Wright suggested that religious and mystical texts should be interpreted in terms of symbols, parables, and analogies, rather than the sources of literal history. In other words, if similar symbols could be detected in Freemasonry, Christian Gnosticism, and Jewish mysticism, then barring documentary evidence to the contrary, it was permitted to conclude that they were in some way connected. Historically problematic, but understandable from the perspective of a romantic and cultural search for spiritual truth. In summing up, Wright's search for kernels of hidden truth, which he believed had been revealed to mankind at the beginning of human history in an original universal air religion, was a consistent theme from his earliest publication in 1906 until his death in 1949. In 1910, he stated that, quote, "We are truth seekers. We seek the truth because we know that the truth will make us free. As truth seekers, we must keep an open mind to receive it from whatever source it may come." This quest led him to investigate reports of psychical and supernatural phenomena and to embrace Theosophy, Buddhism, Islam, and Freemasonry in the 1910s. Though beyond the scope of the short paper, which is just focusing on his earlier discourse, it also led him to explore Jewish mysticism and the Talmud in the 1920s. In the early 1930s, it led him to embrace Roman Catholicism, a religion that he previously criticized for being anti-Masonic, and it was seen that he also drifted away from Freemasonry at the same time that he converted to Catholicism. In the 1940s, he abandoned Catholicism and returned to Islam. At the same time, he also resumed some of his earlier criticisms of Catholicism and so-called orthodox varieties of Christianity. He again suggested, as he had in the mid-1910s, that Islam was the religion that most perfectly resembled the universal truth that had been revealed to mankind at the beginning of human history. Did he find in Islam the truths and answers that he sought? Perhaps in a final analysis, the truth that he sought, that most enchanting of ideas, a single universal foundation at the heart of all religion, was less important than the journey he experienced searching for it. Islam was the only religion Dudley Wright ever re-embraced, and it is thus tempting to believe that before he passed away in 1949, he was satisfied that the spiritual journey had brought him home. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mayer. For those of you who like reading about, reading about the some of the Masonic writings, of course, Dudley Wright produced any number of them. And those of you who are wondering where the various legends come in about Jerusalem's temple and the how so many temples came to look Egyptian, and so you might do worse than read about some of his writings. We've got 5 minutes for questions. Does anybody want to ask Dr. Mayer any question? Yes.
Yeah. Okay, that's actually an interesting question. Like, before we talk about for 10 minutes by itself, done some biographical research on Dudley Wright, going through the various family tree search places and digging in the archives, and actually found out that Dudley Wright changed his name around 1905. So he appears in the census record in 1911 as Dudley Wright, and before that he was Alexander Guy Last. And it turns out that he was married and he did have children. But there's very little about them. You can find the census records for the for his children with the original surname, and then then the same name with a new surname. So yes, I know that he was married. I know that he did have three children, and that's all I know. He never writes about them. There's no biographical information available for them other than what's available in sort of ancestry databases.
Yes.
Okay, I mean, so basically you're asking it whether or not people today treat him seriously.
Today,
in his time. Okay, well, in his time, the impression I get is yes. Now, it's very difficult to be 100% certain because there's not that much direct evidence. There are book reviews of some of his books written in some of the similar sort of periodicals that he wrote in, and some of them are very positive, some of them not quite so positive. But certainly there's sufficient interest in what he was writing that there was plenty of reviews of his books. I mentioned that he was the assistant editor and then the editor of The Freemason, which was the most prominent, I think I'm safe in saying the most prominent English Masonic newspaper at the time. And he used to publish an awful lot of essays, which he converted into books then. So presumably if he wasn't that popular, you know, he wanted to keep that position. And he was also assistant editor and part of editorial teams of four or five other fairly prominent Masonic newspapers or magazines, such as The Builder, Masonic News, which he founded, some others that temporarily slipped my mind. He was the editor of the Annuals of Psychical Science. He was involved in editing the Buddhist Review. He was involved in editing the Islamic, not editing the Islamic Review, but he was part of the team, the Islamic Review. So he was certainly popular enough to be drawn into those type of roles. I hope that gives some sort of indication of. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll pass to our next presenter. After 20 years in the computer industry, Casey Stanislaw, is that how you pronounce it?
Stanislaw.
Returned to academia, and after getting a master's degree in Spanish, specializing in Spanish medieval and early modern literature, he taught Spanish at Baylor University in Texas. By the way, if you haven't noticed, he is a Texan. he's past master of two lodges in Texas, a member of the Scottish Rite, the Royal Archmasons, and the Texas Lodge of Research. His presentation will be broadly on General de Santa Anna. This is a name that is familiar to every Texan born. Santa Anna was a 9 times head of state of Mexico, if you can imagine. He is known in the US and in Texas as the destroyer or the conqueror of the Alamo, where many men considered to be US heroes died, including Sam Houston and Davy Crockett.
Sam Houston survived.
He did. Didn't
Sam Houston wasn't at the Alamo.
Well, there you are, thank you.
That's okay. sorry.
Singularly, Santa Ana is reviled by Mexicans as well, by whom he's considered a traitor, as he gave a large, vast portion of Mexico to the U.S. Some say, and let's see, we can find out, that he did so in exchange for his life. In 2013, a fortuitous encounter led Mr. Stanislaw to an alleged Santa Ana Masonic certificate, which started him on a quest which led to the findings and conclusions that he is going to present to us this afternoon.
Thank you. I'm going to use the handheld mic. Hello. Thank you. I'd like to start with my conclusion, because I wanted to bring those that's not a Texas audience where I've been presenting this, these findings, to let you know how important Santa Ana is to the Texan identity. This portrait is hanging in the state capitol of Texas in Austin. If you ever have a chance to go there and visit it, you should. It is a portrait of the surrender of Santa Ana after the Battle of San Jacinto. Now, to refresh your memory, the Alamo happened, and then Santa Ana's Mexican army pursued Sam Houston's Texan army across Texas. And as they retreated, they finally camped near on San Jacinto Bay. Sam Houston laid in wait the whole time, did not engage until they had basically bivouacked in the afternoon. And at 4 in the afternoon, Sam Houston's vastly... thank you. Sam Houston's troops, who were vastly outnumbered, attacked the Mexicans, and the battle was over in 18 minutes. Santa Ana escaped and was dressed in common clothing of a common soldier, but they captured him, kind of rounding the prisoners up. And so he surrendered. This is a depiction, a stylistic depiction of his surrender at San Jacinto. Here's Sam Houston, who was injured in the battle, who's laying down, receiving Santa Ana. Now, around him are depictions of all the Texas patriots. I bring this up because these guys, most of them were all Masons. And Texans are very... this guy right here, for example, is an ancestor of one of my friends in my hometown, who says, well, why are they holding him back? It's because they wanted to kill Sandy Annie. That's the way my people call it. Well, they would say Sandy Annie. Anyhow, I start there to let you know that this isn't just a passing interest, biographical interest to a Texan. This is very important stuff. And so, was Santa Ana a Mason? That's been speculated upon over the years a great deal. And the patent was discovered in the Livingston Masonic Library Museum in 2008 by our good friend Catherine Walter, who brought it to my attention. We'll talk about how it came to be in New York City. But let's look at our agenda here. Let's talk about what we knew before the patent's discovery, and then we'll take a look at the patent and some of the details of it. Then we'll talk about the context in which the patent was awarded or received, the Masonic context of Santa Ana in his era. Also, is it a forgery? That's a good question. We need to talk about that. So the first thing we need to cover, though, is what they were saying about Santa Ana's Masonry before we knew about the certificate. The most quoted person is this guy, William Denslow, in the book 10,000 Famous Freemasons, 1957, notes that he gave the Masonic hailing sign at San Jacinto. Oh, by the way, that's the source of the legend that says that Sam Houston spared Santa Ana's life because he was a Mason. I don't think that's true, but despite the fact that he is villainized at every turn by Texans, there's still this romantic ideal that there was a Masonic connection and that saved Santa Ana's life. I think that's a legend. We don't need to talk about it here. We're just going to talk about what we know. But that is the thing that's quoted the most. Also, Charles Stewart here, Jose Maria Mateos, who is a famous Mexican historian, says very flatly, Santa Ana era Mason Escocés. He was a Scottish Rite Mason. And perhaps the most quoted Texas historian, this guy here, David Carter. If you're interested in studying anything about Texas Masonry, he is still considered the authority, even though his last edition was published in 1958. So they all confirm that he had Masonic membership of some sort. More recently, Will Fowler, who wrote this excellent biography published in 07, points out his masonry by association. His brother was an Escocés or Scottish Rite Mason. His political allies in the capital were Masons. He was a diehard Federalist associated with the Yorkino cause. But later in his career, he renounced Masonry and even outlawed Masonry at one point. The patent itself, and we're about to take a look at that. Now, what is a patent? It's a certificate on paper attached to vellum, and it was folded up, and a Scottish Rite patent was meant to be produced to verify your Masonic membership, had your signature in the margin. So this patent was discovered in the New York Library, in the New York Library Museum, in Chancellor Livingston Masonic Library Museum, by Catherine Walter, the curator, who was going through, allegedly, I understand it, a closet of stuff, and there it was. And so it's got painted designs, handwritten text, Spanish and Latin, two woven ribbons, two stamped seals, a red wax seal. It's dated December 12th, 1825, issued by the Gran Consistorio Yucateco, or the Grand Consistory of the Yucatan. And it certifies that the recipient is definitely a 32nd degree Scottish Rite Mason. So here's the certificate in toto here. And so let's just point out a few things. So here's the text. We'll look at that a little bit. Where Santa Ana's Ne Veritur would have in this margin is missing. But we've got an angel. We've got the iconic double-headed eagle. We've got a representation here, which I am assured is Jacques de Molay. And a very interesting detail in the upper right. Of course, if you've studied Scottish Rite ritual, you know that's the Ladder of Kadosh. But there is an urn with a sword through it and a triple-headed serpent. So we'll get to this triple-headed serpent. Brent Morris assures me that this is unique. So we'll get to that. Let's talk about what the text of the document actually says. Now, it's a handwritten document, so, you know, it's abbreviated, and I was attending a session where we're talking about Rembrandt, you know, F with three dots. So that this is the same sort of thing in this document, and we don't need to dwell on those details. But it very clearly states that the Grand Consistory of the Yucatan, ancient accepted Scottish Rite of Freemasons, the sovereign and valued princes of the royal secret Knights of Kadosh, ilustres príncipes y caballeros grandes, inefables, sublimes y perfectos. So let's get to the good part. So that all may see, we have duly examined our illustrious brother, Antonio López de Santa Ana, born in Jalapa, state of Veracruz, age 29 years of age, and there's a part missing. He has received different degrees that he has legitimately received, and to his special petition. Now, this is something I think is a very important point. His pedimiento especial, his special petition, remember that. Okay, two things here. December 1825, special petition. So it goes on to list all of his Scottish Rite degrees, which we don't need to list, but they're there. Maestro secreto, secret master, perfect master, intimate secretary, etc. Okay, so here's a zoom in of the document itself. I thought you might enjoy to see that. Again, you can see that it is an abbreviated script, but we can very clearly see nuestro hermano in three dots H, three dots Antonio López de Santa Ana, nacido en Jalapa, estado de Veracruz, edad 29 años. So it's very clear that this is Santa Ana's patent. It's not ambiguous in that respect. Okay, so let's talk about, give you a little brief review on Mexican history during the time period. So to refresh your memory, Napoleon invades Spain it destabilizes Spain, destabilizes all her colonies, and the Councils of Cadiz are formed, which is basically the Spanish government in exile, where, a democratic and fraternal movement starts. So Freemasonry comes into Mexico really through Cadiz and also through maritime trade along the coast. Now, what is people tend to forget was that Mexico actually had an emperor for about 3 years. His name was Agustin Iturbide, and he took over from the Spanish and received basically permission from the Spanish to have a constitutional monarchy. Well, he was a Freemason, and the Scottish Rite Freemasons helped his put him into power. But after about 3 years, he got a little power hungry, abolished Congress, and then another revolution started in 1823. So just to give you an idea about some geography here, Mexico City is in the middle, and this is the Veracruz province. Now, Santa Anna is from Veracruz. We'll come back to that. And he also becomes governor of the Yucatan. Yucatan, that's where the certificate comes from. And here's Cuba. So Veracruz serves as the port of call for Mexico City. All the commerce comes through Veracruz. That's a very important point to remember. So Guadalupe Victoria becomes the president in 1824. So what Santa Anna, he joins, he's a lifelong military man. He joins Iturbide's cause, instigates a revolt after Iturbide abdicates. And in 1824, the government sort of puts him at arm's length. They assign him to the governorship of the Yucatan, which is far away from Mexico City. So out there, they're having a problem because there's the centralists who want to become completely independent from Spain, and then there's all the merchants out there who are still trading with Spanish Cuba. Okay, so he diffuses a civil war, but he doesn't solve the problem. So he becomes involved in a plot to liberate Cuba from the Spanish. And this is, I think, his entry into Masonry. He gets tired of this, and then 1825, April, after petitioning the government, they finally give him permission to go home to Veracruz. He buys a large estate called Manga de Clavo, which is his estate for a long time. He gets married, begins to consolidate local power. Notice two things. He's 31, not 29, and this is April, not December. So I don't need to get into the Scottish Rite versus York Rite, Escocés versus Yorkino battles, but those are mainly political parties that are going on during that time period. And I don't have time to cover that, but let's go straight to what's happening. The York Rite spreads throughout Mexico. Many Scottish Rite lodges affiliate. This York Rite is more independent. They're more common man. The Scottish Rite is a little more aristocratic. I'm painting broad strokes here, but also the Escocés has become identified with Spanish loyalty. So he, why did he become a Scottish Rite Mason? That's a good question. So political allies in the capital are Yorkinos, but all his local homies, sorry to use an American term, they're all Scottish Rite, they're all Escoceses, including his brother, although Santa Anna owns a Yorkino newspaper. So he's clearly playing both sides of the fence here. He's loosely associated with a quasi-Masonic group, La Legión de la Águila Negra, in 1824, which is founded in Jalapa, his hometown. So the Águila Negra was founded by Guadalupe Victoria, who was the president at the time. Its sole purpose was to plan the liberation of Cuba. It had Cubans, and they had an association in Havana. It was a multinational organization, and he had actually been charged to raise troops for the purpose, something that never happened. Anyhow, despite his membership, though, he's never listed. We know he's a Mason now, but he's never listed as a lodge officer, a proponent of Masonry, like many of his contemporaries. And in 1828 was reported as disdainful of all Masonic lodges. So here's a problem with the patent. We've already mentioned them, really. He's 31 in 1825, not 29. And the second, but we can put that down to clerical error, filled out the application wrong, whatever. But he did not reside in the Yucatan when this certificate was issued, which I found fascinating, because it would have necessitated ship travel. He demonstrated a strong desire to return home. And the mention of a petición especial to me suggests that the patent was awarded in absentia. I don't think he was there when the patent was awarded. I think the patent's genuine, but I don't think he was a genuine Mason. Let's put it that way. We've got a couple of things lend credence to its authenticity, though. The first one is the triple-headed serpent. Brent, I wish he was here. Brent told me in an email that he's never seen a triple-headed serpent in any other documents. Now, someone maybe can enlighten me. On the heads of the triple-headed serpent are three crowns. One of them is a papal tiara, which would have been very heretical in the superstitious time period of Mexico in the early 1820s. It would have, his detractors, his enemies would have laid hold of this thing and basically, you know, crucified him. He would have gone down because of this. So it, you got to think that why would a forgery go to the trouble? The second thing is, what's it doing in New York City? I mean, that's what all my Texan brothers want to know. Well, without getting into too much detail, he's exiled. He's living in St. Thomas. He returns to Veracruz in 1864, but the French exile him again. So in 1866, he's visited by U.S. Secretary of State William Seward at the time, and he's convinced that he is going to be brought back to power in Mexico. So he goes to New York. He mortgages his estate of Manga de Clavo and some other properties, and he lives in Elizabethport, New Jersey, which is right across from Staten Island. When he runs out of money, he moves to Staten Island, and we know that the patent was donated to the Livingston Museum by the master of America's Lodge number 535 in Whitestone, New York, which was then that lodge is merged with another lodge, but that was in Queens in 1960. So from then until 08, it was not cataloged properly. I thought you'd be interested in this, which is a war bond side note. He issued $750,000 in war bonds, which mortgaged his estate and all his properties in Mexico. You can buy these online on eBay. Now, it's strangely enough, the Barry's name is not filled in. Those are blank, but Santa Ana's signature is there at the bottom. And that's a picture of him at age 71, 72, when he's thinking that he's coming back to power. You got to give it to him. The guy never quit. So just kind of summing up here. My hypothesis, just two things I really discovered. The first thing is, I think he had a political need to show his Masonic affiliation, probably to gain entry into the Legion de la Águila Negra, Legion of the Black Eagle, and could not or would not join a local lodge. So he called upon his old allies in Mérida to certify his Masonic membership. And we know that he waved the thing around. There's some other historians who sort of note that he was had Scottish Rite, a Scottish Rite affiliation. And then we know that he produced the thing in 1866 while he was in New York. And at the time, Benito Juarez, Maximilian was on the throne in Mexico. This is when during the Maximilian era, and Juarez was trying to gain support. Well, there were supporters in the U.S. For Juarez, and when they heard about Santa Anna being in New York, well, they denounced him. You know, they're like, he's a traitor. We don't want anything to do with him. There was a Juarista club in New York City. And so I think he was trying to gain some credibility, trying to sell his war bonds, and took his patent out and waved it around a little bit. That's what I think, and that's how it ended up in New York. So in the conclusions, what we have learned is that it's a unique surviving example from its time period. I would really, prominent researcher, that's Brent, I would really like to dig into this matter of the three-headed serpent a little bit more and see what we can uncover. Maybe there's a link to the Legion de la, the Legion of the Black Eagle there. And the second thing is, From a Texan standpoint, we have relied too long on old research, and we need to incorporate new and modern research, especially that being done in Spanish language, which has not been done. So we'll go back to the last slide. I think the next step is that, see, Santa Ana, in my mind, is a huge barrier to our Masonic research, because I think that the period, the impresario period from about 1823, 1824, up to Revolution, we totally overlook that. And if all these guys were Masons, then there were guys on the other side, on the Mexican side, that they were collaborated with, that they were countrymen with, up to that time that were also Masons. What was their Masonic affiliation? That's the real next paper, next presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Casey. You must have noticed now that Santa Ana is a man of incredible notoriety in the Republic of Texas.
Yeah, the Republic, thank you, yes.
You know, a traitor to the Mexicans, you know, a rogue, a villain, a manipulator. We've heard what Texans thought of him. A conundrum to the Masons, because on the one hand, was he a Mason or not, and we wish he weren't. Thank you, Casey, for Salomonically determining that, A, yes, he was, but we have nothing to be ashamed of.
Yes.
Any questions? Ms. Romero.
Permiso. It's okay.
Okay. There is a very extended legend in Cuba that all the documents related to Masons linked to the Gran Logia del Águila Negra conspiration were forged after the police searches in Matanzas and in La Habana. So I think that if they forged in Matanzas and in La Habana for that purpose, maybe they're forged too in New York or in Yucatan.
Well, it's possible. It's possible that it was forged. I mean, it's still not impossible that it wasn't forged. But it would have been forged by this kind of conspiracy. I mean, it would have been something. I do believe, though, that his masonry was connected with Águila Negra, and I've only read a couple of articles about it, and mainly by Maru Vasquez. And I'm really interested to follow up on that line of research, because I think there's really something there. And when I presented this to a Texan crowd, a guy, of course, brought up his own Texan conspiracy theories that said, well, you know, there was a conspiracy to create a great Southern empire that would also have been centered around Havana. And so who knows if that's linked into. So,
yes. I want to take the mic. Casey, I really enjoyed your presentation, because I think Santa Ana is understudied, particularly on the Mexican side. As you know, you mentioned Maru Vasquez and myself, and we have a book on Mexican Freemasonry, and we don't talk much about Santa Ana. I don't know why. Maybe it's in the subconscious that we don't want a person who was 11 times president, had some charisma. But
yeah, he did.
But we don't want to think about that. But I think something that you need to remember is that at that particular time in the 20s, the Scottish and the Yorkinos and Scoceses were going back and forth. So maybe it's difficult to get record. And Guadalupe Victoria, the first president of Mexico, he was Yorkino as well as later. So and they were the Legión del Águila Negra. So just try to see. It's difficult because we have tried, but don't forget that they were back and forth. They were flip-flopping, like really flip-flopping because of political reasons. And also we need to think about the role of the Mexican national right here, because some of them were. The Mexican National Right was also created in 1825. So I think that's something that to think, keep in mind. I don't have the answer, but just...
Well, it's interesting that, yes, the York Right was founded with the help of Jules Poinsett, the American ambassador, in 1825. And reportedly by a lot of Scottish Rite Masons who were disillusioned with where they... where the Escocese movement was going, so they formed York Rite Lodges. And many Scottish Rite Lodges converted. They just became York Rite Lodges. And so, yes, during that time period, there was a lot of flip-flopping going back and forth. And so the question sort of arises is, you know, Fowler says, well, he was identified as a Yorkino in his politics and in his associations. And so it kind of begs the question is, well, why did a Scottish Rite patent then show up in December of 1825? In my mind, I think it was sort of his shortest path. You know, he could lay his hands on that and then go, hey, let me in your club. That's kind of what I think he did. And so that was just his entry. Maybe he became a Yorkino after that. Who knows?
I mean, the same way that he as president was centralist and then federalist.
Right.
So he was flip-flopping also in his political career. So that's it. And the last thing about the apron, I mean, about the pan,
yeah.
I think they, during those times, also the use of symbolism was so, I mean, deliberate and so without any conscience that those were the artists. I mean, we even see it in today's Mexico. I mean, people wearing the Star of David without knowing that. I mean, if they come to many other countries, they will think that they are Jewish, but no, it's because they just like it. I mean, so don't give away. I don't think it's a forgery,
no.
But it might be. But I mean, just to think that. But we have a lot to talk about because it's very exciting. But
well,
just
as a last point, that's a very good point, but I think there's a couple of other very deliberate details on that document. First of all is another researcher told me, that's not just any old knight of Kadosh, that's Jacques de Molay. That's a representation of Jacques de Molay. And also the stamps, which we didn't have a chance to look at, do say Gran Cosa Historio. So I tend to think that was a deliberate sort of symbolism. I don't think it was by accident. I don't think it was just an artistic liberty.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Guillermo. And by the way, good luck with your book, and I don't think you're getting Texas back.
Thank you.
Any other questions? If not, we'll go on to our next and last presenter, Ms. Maria Danova. She's an assistant of library projects at the Goethe Institute in Russia, and part of the team of project, do you pronounce it all?
Zhenia, please pronounce it.
Ah. Stands for Aesthetics of Western Esotericism.
Yeah, and we have the founder and the co-founder of this project right here.
Oh, very good. Yeah. Welcome. A nonprofit organization, you'll excuse me if I make a mistake in explaining what R is. A nonprofit organization on a mission to explore, I copied it from your website, so I hope it's right. to explore forgotten connections between Hermetic Kabbalist traditions and art. R seeks to provide new dimensions to understanding and experiencing cultural icons of Western European heritage. So far? Excellent. Ms. Danova received her literary and art criticism degree at the Lomonosov, and I don't know how to pronounce that.
Lomonosov
Moscow State University. She's long been fascinated with the topic of mysticism in art, with a special focus on music. Inspired by the lectures on Freemasonry and history of religion by theologist Leonid Matsik, Ms. Danova is currently creating a series of essays for Project R, The Secret of the Magic Flute, Western Music, and Esotericism. Her presentation today is on Richard Wagner's lifelong interest in Freemasonry and what effect this may have had on his work.
Thank you. Does it work? Yeah. Thank you. So first of all, when we hear the name Richard Wagner, of course, we do not immediately associate him with Freemasonry. His name sometimes raises very unpleasant emotions, especially in Germany, but unexpectedly, there is a lot to explore when it comes to his connections with the Freemasonic Brotherhood and ideas. So I would like to start just with presenting some key facts as far as his family Masonic connections go. So his first Masonic influences, one may say, were his fathers. I have written it like this because there exists a doubt whether who of those two men was his biological father and who his stepfather. So Carl Friedrich Wilhelm Wagner was his alleged biological father, and it is stated in one biographical sketch written by a brother from Hamburg, Germany, that he was a Freemason, but the name of the lodge is not given, unfortunately, so we cannot fully trust this information. This father died only 6 months after Richard's birth, and afterwards his mother married Ludwig Geyer, the friend of Carl Friedrich, and Wagner called him his spiritual father, and stated that his earliest recollections of childhood were associated with him. And he was a proven member of the Lodge Ferdinand zu Glückseligkeit in Magdeburg. This is his self-portrait. He was a very talented man and multifaceted personality who introduced Richard to the world of art. Okay, my watch came up. And it was in Magdeburg, where Ludwig Geyer was in a lodge, that Wagner later used to visit free concerts arranged by these two lodges, Ferdinand and Harpocrates. And interestingly, in 1835, he even presented his overture to the fairies at the lodge premises there. Further on, his brother-in-law, who married his sister Rosalie, and unfortunately they were married just for 1 year before she died, he was a high-ranking Freemason, and as you can see, a long-lasting one, and held an honorary membership in over 50 lodges, besides being the chair of Balduin zur Linde. And William Denslow, who was already mentioned before, calls him one of the most important personalities in Freemasonry during Wagner's time. And Denslow claims that it was from Marbach that Wagner could learn much of Masonic ritual and ideas that he later allegedly used while composing and writing the libretto for Parsifal. Then we skip quite a long time further and discuss this man. This is Friedrich Feustel. He was a banker in Bayreuth, the town where Wagner built his famous art temple, the Festspielhaus in Bayreuth. Friedrich Feustel was, as you can see, the Grand Master of the Grand Lodge zur Sonne, to the Sun. And it was to this man that Wagner applied to actually join a Masonic lodge. This lodge was called Eleusis zur Verschwiegenheit, Eleusis to the Silence. For some reason, he was rejected. And there are many. I have used the German sources because there is almost nothing written in English regarding this topic. And the German brethren who wrote about it claim that it might have been internal controversies in the lodge, because many members reproached Wagner for his personal life and character. There is a typo, Feustel's fear that Wagner's admission would strengthen the opposition of the Bavarian clericals, because the relations between Freemasonry and the church were quite strained at the time. Then it was perhaps the advice of other Freemasons, friends and associates, and again, character and personal life. Just to give an example of how unbearable Wagner could be as a person sometimes. once, as Professor Robert Greenberg tells in his lectures about Wagner, he abruptly screamed while sitting in a company of people just to draw attention to himself, because he thought that he was underestimated at the moment. So, as we can see, there is no actual proof, although I have contacted a Freemason from Germany, and he told me that his friend, also a Freemason but in Italian, has some proof, some certificate that that actually gives us information that Wagner joined a lodge, but for some reason he doesn't want to provide it, so we are left with no evidence so far. But let us just go into the realm of speculations, and please do not be strict, because I do not claim that what I'm presenting is the ultimate truth. So Walter Klein once said about the famous German composer Arnold Schoenberg, the other reformer of European music after Wagner, "One is made a theosophist not by membership, but by one's way of thinking." This is, of course, a stretch, but just to entertain this idea is also interesting. Wagner, as for example, Roger Scruton claims, was an artist with an agenda, and this agenda was nothing less than the redemption of humankind. This is a very large-scale task, and we can claim that Freemasonry is up to the same task in a way, because Freemasonry is about developing your own soul and your whole being to the perfection, and thus reaching a universal perfection of the humankind. Wagner called this concept redemption of humankind Erlösung, and this word greatly irritated Friedrich Nietzsche. He wrote in his essay on Wagner, when they separated, so to speak, that Wagner is all about Erlösung. So this Erlösung was expressed by Wagner thus. He wrote in 1849 in his essay Art and Revolution that the artwork of the future that he wanted to achieve, that he wanted to create, must embrace the spirit of a free mankind delivered from every shackle of hampering nationality. You might be surprised, of course, because 20 years later he would write his hideous pamphlet about Jewry in music, but at that time he wrote these wonderful words. And he literally wrote that in the future we need to achieve the brotherhood of man, die brüderliche Menschheit. I think it coincides very nicely with the Freemasonic ideas. And the most famous word associated with Wagner is the term Gesamtkunstwerk, is the total work of art. He used it in those same essays he wrote in 1849, Art and Revolution and the Artwork of the Future. And it may be viewed as a restoration of the ancient unity of the arts and return to the mysteries that existed in antiquity. And Rudolf Steiner, in his lecture, Wagner and Mysticism, wrote that Wagner believed that the time had come for a reunion of the arts, and so he set to this task. This process of reuniting the arts can be compared with the myth of Isis gathering the body parts of Osiris, in fact. Another interesting statement from a brother, Dennis Henney,
who wrote an article about the three allegedly Masonic operas, The Magic Flute, Fidelio, and Parsifal, Brotherly Love, Relief, and Truth. There he speculated that Wagner's life was filled with such interventions that can lead us to think that he was either a Freemason or was closely associated with this brotherhood and received certain help from them. It is not proven by any factual evidence, but we cannot deny that these strange interventions and assistance did occur, and he actually got help. So, as you can see, we cannot state anything with certainty. So let us explore some other details of Wagner's personality and image that might be associated with Freemasonry. Wagner can often be seen on various portraits and photographs showing this gesture, the hidden hand. Whether or not it has any actual Masonic meaning is unknown, but let us see what reasons there might have been for that. First of all, it could have been a demonstration of his patriotic, anti-Napoleonic sentiments. His father, the first one, died soon after the Battle of the Nations. So it is possible that he took this very personally also and appropriated this gesture to somehow oppose the power of Napoleon and appropriate his power through this gesture, which is, of course, only a speculation. Then it is an aristocratic posture, perhaps. And at this point, I would like to quote from a book from 1738, written by François Nivellon, called A Book of Gentile Behavior. And there, the hand and waistcoat posture is described as signifying manly boldness tempered with modesty. And this posture was later appropriated or used by the aristocrats. Then it is a posture used by orators, such as Aeschines, a Greek orator. But at the same time, Goethe, a proven Freemason, also shows this gesture. So let us see whether it has any Masonic implications. In Duncan's Masonic Ritual and Monitor from 1861, we see this gesture as prescribed to the Master of the Second Veil. Then, in Richardson Masonic Monitor of 1860, the two sources were written back in Wagner's lifetime. It is also given as an illustration to the procedure of initiation to the Master of the Second Veil. Of course, maybe Mr. Stanislaw knows better about it, and probably he will comment whether it is relevant or not. Then the second element of the Wagner brand is the beret. As far as is known, Wagner first appeared in the beret in 1867, when he was already 54 years old, so it must have been some conscious decision signifying something. Probably he wanted to emphasize that he became a master of sorts, a master in the arts. Jenny Gershman, who is in this room right now, wrote to me in our personal correspondence about this issue that it's not only a fashion statement, it's not only an artist's beret, but that it comes from the guild rules and where only the master could wear the hat, and it might be viewed as a symbol of maturity and independence, parallel to Master of the Lodge. In continuation of Zhenya's presentation on Wagner, I would like to give you this visual comparison where you can just see how alike in their attire, in their posture, these two men are. You can see the beret on both of them, and you can see the hidden hand. These images are many, many years apart, 1638 and 1867. Then we can see the two men in the beret again. As for the significance of the hat, of a cover for the head in Freemasonry, Albert G. Makey, in his Encyclopedia of Freemasonry, writes that there is no craft practice in general, and in Masonic practice in particular, no custom more honored or more ancient than to wear the hat, that the master should wear the hat. In ancient times, the Masons used to convene within closed portals with covered heads. Here, this is a nice image to illustrate my point, which is even not a point, but a speculation again. Here you can see Wagner portrayed as the single person in the room wearing any headgear. You can see Liszt, who was a proven Freemason, present at this gathering, and you can see a man standing next to Liszt, who is demonstrating the hidden hand gesture. It is not specified anywhere who this man is, but we can speculate that he belonged to a lodge, perhaps, or that he just wanted to show his aristocratic position. In view of this image, it is interesting to mention that his associates, his relatives, friends, adherents called him master or revered master. Here are examples. Nietzsche and Cosima refer to him mostly as the master. And it was the same in the Pythagorean Brotherhood of Antiquity, where Pythagoras was referred to only as the master, and any controversies in the Brotherhood were resolved simply by saying the master said, and if he said something, then it was over. Wagner wrote at one point about Pythagoras directly in his Religion and Art. A mystery enwrapped Pythagoras, the preacher of vegetarianism. We know that Wagner was a vegetarian himself. No philosopher since him had pondered on the essence of the world without recurring to his teaching. Silent fellowships were founded, remote from turmoil of the world, to carry out this doctrine as a sanctification from sin and misery. Wagner doesn't say directly which fellowships he actually means, but we, by extension, may add perhaps the Freemasonic Fellowship of Brotherhood to this. What is...
1 minute.
1 minute, okay. Then we'll just skip, because I wanted to give like all the music examples then. Okay, Pythagoras was an important figure, is an important figure in Freemasonry. He had the doctrine of the music of the spheres, based on his discovery of basic musical intervals: the octave, the perfect fifth, the perfect fourth, and the perfect fourth. So here I would like to illustrate. Oh, how do I do this? Let me see. How do I turn the music on? Okay. Let us see this harmonic series based on these... Okay. Based on these what? I'm sorry.
Put it in the middle there. Yeah, there you go.
It's Das Rheingold by Wagner. This is just the single note, which is going to be followed by an octave, a fifth, and a fourth. So it's going to last for a few measures. And it's important to say, to note that for Wagner, the fifth was very important. For him, this interval was closely associated with ghosts and spirits and with the spirit world in general. And this interval is very much present in Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, which is considered a Masonic symphony, of course, not directly, but at least it has this message of the brotherhood of man. For Wagner, Wagner thought that this symphony must surely contain the secret of all secrets. Just another example, how the Ninth Symphony starts with the fifths, with the long sustained fifths. Here you can see them. Sorry to interrupt the music, but I have to. For Wagner, Beethoven was incredibly important. He called him the master. He wrote a novel called A Pilgrimage to Beethoven, where he composed an imaginary meeting and with Beethoven and a so-called kiss of consecration from this composer. Of course, we should not forget this statement written by Wagner. Although it is written like on part of a character in a novel, it is interesting as an apostolic creed, so to speak. I believe in God, Mozart, the well-known Mason, and Beethoven, an unproven Mason, but close to Freemasonry. And likewise, they're disciples and apostles. I believe in the Holy Spirit and the truth of the one indivisible art, etc. Here, I just give a chain of succession that Wagner, I think, wanted to belong to. Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, and then Wagner. Franz Liszt was his close friend and father-in-law, and he belonged to lodges and was elected a master. This is a comparison, just, okay. Yeah. Yeah, just, okay, just 2 minutes, I will skip to the end, right. We started 10 minutes later. Okay.
10 minutes,
oh, okay. So then the most interesting, so the tetralogy of the ring is, I think, associated with the Tetractys, the Pythagorean figure encompassing the whole cosmos. And in the same way, the ring tetralogy encompasses the whole cosmos as well. Wagner said that it contains the world's beginning and its end. Okay, then this is not the most interesting part. And in Parsifal, it is important to say that many Masons think that it is a Freemasonic opera. And, okay, there is a connection between Parsifal and Kabbalah, which we will not explore now. And this is a connection between Parsifal and the Duomo di Siena, which inspired Wagner to create this Grail temple. And here we are at the end, at the finale of Parsifal, Act 1. Okay, which is, it is pointless to just talk about it so quickly. So my point is that as the Freemasons strive to a universal league of mankind, which they now aspire to exhibit on a small scale, Wagner, at the best point of his life, also wanted to achieve the same goal. And as Arnold Schoenberg, who was already mentioned at the beginning, wrote, the laws of the man of genius are the laws of future humanity. It is only left for us to hope that this universal league of mankind will sometime in the future will be created. This is Wagner's memorial in Berlin, inside the arch, which was built only like maybe two decades ago or more, and the Royal Arch. So I will wrap it up.
Thank you
for being so lengthy.
I've read your whole paper. So you sent it and you did a magnificent job in trying to summarize it all in the 20 minutes that we had.
It was very hard to summarize because there are so many details that I could explain.
Exactly. Well, thank you very much. We might perhaps have time for one or two questions. Yes.
With the mask, death mask of Wagner, because I have hoped that in your explanation there is a key with the mask. Have you information about Venetian mask?
Since I'm only at the beginning of this research, and this is almost as a sketch, and I'm planning to go much further, I haven't any information about this yet, but thank you very much. I will explore it.
And it would be very interesting to know suddenly after the death who were the persons who are with Wagner's family in the palace, and perhaps if you find some Mason, it would be a good development of your hypothesis.
Yes, I wanted to point out too that I am very much open to collaborators from the Freemasonic realm and from musicology, because I'm only an amateur musician. It would be great to get this help. I hope that in the future it will come.
I have a question for you. Do you think there is a relationship between the fact of covering the head in the temple and the Jewish yarmulke or kippah?
Excuse me?
Do you think, you mentioned the fact of Freemasons covering their heads in the temple. Do you think there is a relationship between this fact and the Jewish tradition of covering their heads in the temple also?
I think the tradition of covering one's head is spread all over the globe. In fact, in Orthodox religion, we also have our own version of covering the head, but it's the opposite. The women should cover their heads and the men should uncover. So I think perhaps there exists an affinity between these two traditions. It's just because the temple is a sacred place, and of course, I cannot say any details about it right now, but I think there is an affinity.
Thank you.
If you look at the painter's master's hat, if they were advanced in the guild, in the Master St. Luke's guild tradition in the Renaissance, if you look, the self-portraits of one of the greatest example would be Titian. It is identical to the yarmulke in the Jewish tradition, and we do know that there is such huge influence of Kabbalah, which we call the Western Kabbalah, of course, that it is very possible that there is an overlap in terms of inspiration for why I wear it.
All right, thank you so much.
We have to go,
I think.
Is this working? Yes. Well, thank you very much, and will you join me in thanking our three presenters of today? Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we have a reception to go to.